loved the world, that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world. But people loved darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be seen plainly that what they have done has been done in the sight of God. Here ends the reading. Please be seated. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, first of all, thank you for the invitation to have me come and worship with you this morning and share some thoughts on our heavy but awesome scriptures for today, and maybe share a little bit about how I see those things playing out in Lutheran Outdoor Ministries, specifically just an hour north of here at Camp Iwalu. As Pastor Rodney said, my name is Jesse Klosterbohr. I'm the and I don't blame you, it's a long job title. It's Associate Director for Development and Program at the camp. And so basically, my job at Iwalu is to be in charge of recruiting and hiring and training and supervising our 50 full-time, actually double shift time, youth ministry staff over the course of the 2.5 months of summer. It's also my job to get the word out about summer camp and do some promotions and just invitations, and also sculpt our 20 different summer camp programs for kids grades 1 through 12 and families as well, to sculpt those in order to strengthen the ministry of the congregations. That's what the camp is for. That's why Iwalu was started in 1961, not as a separate approach or a competing and an alternative to a Christian community and a church, but to augment that as something that, like Jesus took his disciples on the mountainside, not to stay up there in the wilderness, but so that they would be inspired and equipped and prepared to go back down into the cities and towns and countryside. Outdoor ministry is the same way. Sunday morning worship, I believe, is the same way, right? You know, what happens here is about your workplace, about your school, about your home, about your family, about your Facebook. It's about everything, right? The earth is the Lord's and all that is in it, the world and those who live in it, the Psalms tell us. And we believe in a God who is that far-reaching into our lives, that through the sacrament of holy baptism, it's not up to us to climb a ladder and be good enough like pretty much every other religion I've seen. But in Christianity, and especially, I love how Lutherans get this so scripturally right. Jesus, if there ever was a ladder, Jesus jumped down it, right? Because of God's love, because of Christ's love for us. He jumped down that ladder to be with us and says in baptism, you are mine, you are saved, you are forgiven. I love you, and you are mine. That's the gospel we heard today. And the awesome lyrics of the choir singing, when they sang, "This is love," right? And they and the lyrics. I hope you're listening because they were solid. They were straight from the readings from today. A lot of those. In the first reading, Moses and the people—they were getting tired. They were suffering. You know, if you think we suffer ailments today, think of life without doctors and dentists, right? They were suffering and lacking food and the basics. And they started to doubt God. You know, I think we are tempted as well to think of God as our holy shopping cart. I know I am sometimes. God, I know you could. Why don't you? Just help me out here. It's hard to blame them. But they did doubt. They did not believe. They doubted Moses and they doubted God. And so they suffered more, and serpents came out and bit them. And then something happened that happens in the other readings as well. The scripture tells us those two key words that you've heard a million times. But God, maybe not in those two words, but in the plot twist, in the turn of the story, what happened? The Hebrew people, they repented. They're like, you know what? We complained and we shouldn't have. We got no right. God is our Savior. We don't deserve anything. God is doing this for us. And what can we do to get right with God? And just like the prodigal son, whose father, you know, he came back after sinning terribly, and he came back, and before he could even deliver his speech to his dad and saying, I'm sorry, his dad ran to meet him when he was a long ways off. And before he could deliver the speech, his father put his robe around the son and welcomed him back into the community. May this be a congregation, friends, where there's no hoops to jump through. There's no hazing like in a frat, although, you know, friendly kidding about crafts and things, that's kind of, you know, that's among friends, I know. But may this be a congregation where people walk in for the first time and they hear loud and clear, congratulations, you're in. You're it. That's it. You're a member. You belong. You know? When I came this morning, I was greeted in that way. A couple of gentlemen helped me in and helped me know where to go. It was great. You got a good thing going here. That is the hospitality of Christ that we're called to. When Jesus is at the center, it all comes together. And we hear in the gospel, just as Moses lifted up that serpent in the wilderness so that people who believed and came, they were healed of the poison from the asps and the snakes and stuff. They were healed. A miracle, right? God cares about us. He wants us to come back to him, not just once in our life, but daily, sometimes hourly, if you're like me. You know, we need God. We need that reminder, as Paul gives us in the second lesson for today. And that's so perfect, because this summer at Iwalu, we are looking at that theme verse as our pivotal verse for the summer, Ephesians 2, verse 8. For by grace you, is it, could be saved through faith? No, by grace you have been saved through faith, the Bible tells us. And this is not your own doing, not the result of works. You can't take credit for this stuff, friends. And the longer we're in a church or a camp or a staff or a family or a Christian community, the harder some things get, I think. And the harder it is to fight the pride that we have overcome, what we have overcome and what you have overcome in faith. Am I right? The longer it, you know, some things get easier over time. I think that gets harder. But the gospel comes back and puts us in our seat and says, you have been saved through faith by grace, an undeserved gift. I tell my youth ministry staff, I say, you know, a good way to remember what is grace, that defining characteristic of God's relationship with us, I think. Well, each letter stands for something, like an acronym, G-R-A-C-E, stands for God's riches at Christ's expense. I kind of like that. You know, that has been given to you. We are saved by that. And that is the good news. Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. We focus on that. A good friend of mine who later, after Iwalu, went on to smuggle Bibles into about 11 countries in Southeast Asia, including Myanmar, what used to be known as Burma, and deep in China, risking her life to do these things and bring the Word of God to some dark places. She told me, you know, Jess, I've discovered if you want to feel the heat, you got to stay close to the fire. You got to communicate with other believers. You got to be in community. Can you be a Christian by yourself? I once asked my dad, considering a monastic lifestyle at one point and things, and he said, well, I think you can, but not for long. Not for very long. You know, if you want to feel the heat, like on a chilly June night around the campfire, you got to stay close. Thank you for coming close this morning to hear the Word of God and be around other believers and connect with God in prayer and song. That happens at camp. That's why we do what we do at camp. you know. It's so that kids can be strengthened in their faith, and families. You know, I love the vision of outdoor ministries, you know, that we envision congregations and communities filled with leaders of all ages, transforming the world by living like Jesus Christ. And at Iwalu, our mission statement, specifically in our style of outdoor ministries for all ages, every weekend of the year we have church councils out there and men's groups and women's groups and crafters and property committees doing some visioning stuff together and overnight and some adult-friendly lodging these days. It's good. But the mission is that in the rhythm of Christian life, 24/6, right, in a six-day camp week, in the rhythm of Christian life together, we can, you know, Iwalu serves as a place apart to connect the Word of God with the world of God. And I know that's happening here as well as St. Paul. How do we know? Well, I could sit here and bore you all day. I'll save that for the hot topics downstairs, but yeah, there's a sale point there. with some statistics and studies and really, I think, are super exciting things that confirm what we've suspected all along in outdoor ministries for at least the almost 60 years that Iwalu's been doing it, and over 100 years that Lutheran outdoor ministry has been a formal thing. A couple of those. It's found that a study from about 7 years ago was done, and they gave a bunch of kids the opportunity to go to camp, age like 8 to 11, I think it was. And then they measured 5 years later how many of those kids versus the kids, same kids in the congregation, who weren't given the opportunity. It wasn't like they said you couldn't come. It's just like they gave sudden surprise, random full rides, right, to some and not others. The kids that went to a Lutheran camp for a week, 5 years later, were three times more likely to attend church regularly. That means, okay, so they're 9 years old, 5 years later, as a 14-year-old, instead of 15% of those 14-year-olds attending congregations regularly, that's at least twice a month is what they use. Instead of 15%, it was 45% attended church regularly after a week at camp. The top comment we get in Lutheran Outdoor Ministries from parent evaluations. This is the last stat, I promise you. But, you know, we survey the kids, we survey the parents too, and we ask them a bunch of questions. One of those questions is, how do you feel that a week at Bible camp benefited your son or daughter? And we ask for criticisms and everything else too, of course. But on that question, how did it benefit your son or daughter? The top answer we get, thankfully it's positive, very positive, is, my child does things without being asked now. Like, helps out. My son is just about to turn 2 years old, and I'm eager to send him to Bible camp someday. But that's interesting. Is it because it's a boot camp? Discipline? Not really. It's a safe place, you know. Respect is not optional. You know, we're respectful of each other. We're caring. But I think it's in large part because of cell phones. And the shocking culture shock, really, of suddenly being without the cell phone. I was mistaken. There's one more number I'm going to share with you. And you may have heard this before, but this is thousands of kids across the country that they looked at. And they look every year because this is a major thing. Our brains are developing physically differently, like new folds, new different things happening in our physical brains after cell phones, and there's a perfect correlation. Not that they're bad. I use them all the time. But youth ages 7 through 17, and this is a 2017 number, so it's probably still growing, on average spend well over 8, now almost 9 hours a day using electronic screens for entertainment purposes. 9 hours a day, 7 days a week. That's outside of schoolwork and homework on computers. That's in addition to 9 hours a day. That's time that's not being spent looking people in the eye and connecting face to face and building empathy. There's now articles on what's called an empathy deficit, where kids can't really, you know, I mean, a lot, not all, But a lot of kids and youth and even counselors in college, I find doing tons of interviews every year with college students, it's hard to connect with people as much and to know what to say and to know how to look people in the eye. A week at camp increases empathy skills measurably by 30%. I can quote you that study too. Oh man, there's another one. I'm sorry, I keep going. That's back to the levels it was in the 1990s. That's more empathy than is typically grown. Those skills in 2 or 3 years of growing up life happens in 1 week of camp because they're helping each other out. They're living in community. They're having fun, and they're so busy having adventures and really connecting and really being heard and trying new things that they don't have time to miss their phones. That goes for our staff, too. It's great. It's the perfect detox, you know, from a screen lifestyle, and it lasts. So thank you on behalf of 1,000 kids who come, 800 more who come off-site to our VBS programs, where we have teams of youth ministers who lead that in churches, 21 and counting for this coming summer, different churches, ELCA churches in Eastern Iowa. Thank you on behalf of the seminaries, the Lutheran seminaries. This fall, among our recent counselors who graduated college, we had 5 start to Lutheran MDiv tracks from EULU this year. Not that we can take total credit. Congregations had a ton to do with that, but I like to think that we at least nurtured them and helped be a pivot point to discern the call to full-time ministry. 5 people are going to be pastors just this year from working at EULU. Thank you on behalf of all those parents and the 180 congregations whose kids return more connected with the life and ministry of their home church. That's why I do it. My wife's a Lutheran pastor. My dad was. I am doing what I'm doing and devoted my life to this stuff to strengthen as much as I can the awesome ministry that each of you are doing in this community through powerful immersive Christian retreats, which, by the way, any kid can come to. If there's you have a grandchild or maybe even a friend of theirs from school without a church connection, and all their family can afford is 10 cents to go to EULU, yes, the actual cost of providing that week is about $735 because we're top quality, you know, right up along an $1,100 typical sports camp. Subsidies, year-round retreat rentals, family reunions help get that cost down, and careful nonprofit management get it down to about $440. But if that family can only pay 10 cents, they get to go to camp. That's our policy. Thanks to that support and God providing. This is love, that while you were still sinners, as the choir anthem said this morning, before you knew God, God knew and loved you. Let's remember grace this week as we go out into the world. Grace that God claimed us and invited us to come to the table and receive, simply receive, his love for us so that others may see our good works and maybe not remember us, but they may see what we do and see that grace and actually believe that there could be a God who has the same spirit as you, the spirit of love. Amen.